Now programming from the Illinois Channel, an independent nonpartisan corporation formed to provide nonpartisan coverage of Illinois state government and other public affairs events taking place across Illinois. For more information on the Illinois Channel, please visit our website at www.illinoischannel.org.
Just ahead, we head to the state capitol press briefing room, where Senate President John Cullerton, and later Senate Republicans and Senate Democrats, hold press conferences to discuss why the proposed grand bargain budget deal will not be passed. Then in about 45 minutes from now, we head to the Senate floor to hear the debate over the grand bargain budget deal, which was composed of 16 different bills. And finally, in about 1 hour and 30 minutes from now, Governor Rauner is joined by Felicia Norwood, the director of the Illinois Department of Healthcare and Family Services, along with several doctors, as they discuss proposals to expand managed care of Illinois Medicaid. That's all just ahead, after a brief word from one of our advisory council members.
Hi, I'm Dave Treader, president of the Federation of Independent Illinois Colleges and Universities. For years, Illinois was known around the world for the quality of its colleges and universities, and not just our public universities, but the many private schools that do such a great job educating more students annually than the public's. Schools like Bradley University in Peoria, Millikan University in Decatur, Loyola University in Chicago, and Northwestern University in Evanston. These are just a few examples of the schools that not only educate the next generation, but also serve as economic engines for their communities, with tens of millions of dollars in payroll and the purchasing of millions of dollars in local services. In fact, the combined economic impact of Illinois' private colleges and universities is over $20 billion annually. Collectively, these schools account for $3.5 billion in state tax revenues annually. Illinois' independent colleges and universities are a key pillar of the economy, bring in billions of dollars to the Illinois economy, as well as adding a cultural richness to our communities. That's why it's important that the state programs like the Monetary Award Program, which enables low-income Illinois residents to attend college in our great state, remain funded. And it's also why it's important for all of us to understand the economic impact of our colleges and universities have on the Illinois economy and our communities. This is why I'm also happy to serve on the Illinois Channel Advisory Council on Higher Education. Their statewide, in-depth coverage of the issues that impact our economy, our government, and our cultural resources help to inform us all on the issues that matter. I'm Dave Treader, president of the Federation of Independent Illinois Colleges and Universities, and proud to be a member of the Illinois Channel Advisory Council.
Next from Springfield, on February 28th, the Senate debated the so-called grand bargain budget deal. The following day, Senate President Cullerton and the Senate Republicans and Senate Democrats held press conferences to discuss why the budget deal would not be passed, as Republican senators made it clear they would not vote in favor of further bills attached to the grand bargain. This runs about 45 minutes.
We're planning on calling the rest of the bills dealing with the grand bargain, and we did not call the bills because Senator Redonio told me after we negotiated all day over some more items that if we were to call the bills that there would be very little, if any, Republican support other than herself. And this was always designed to be a bipartisan effort. Many of these tough bills, as you could see from the ones that we've already voted on, require support from both parties. So that's as a result, there's no sense in calling the bills and having them be defeated, especially since it's my intention to hopefully continue to pass this grand bargain. It's essential to the governor's budget. The governor himself even said grand bargain in his budget documents. I think he said that his budget was short about $4.5 billion. We later found out it was short about $6.5 billion. So I assume that the next move is the governor's to tell us why these Republican senators were voting no on bills that he supported. Yesterday we had a pension bill that I can tell you we took language directly from his staff I had personally negotiated that pension bill with him earlier, and he insisted that I go out and call the bill. And I told him it's complicated passing bills. And he's proved that because his own party didn't support the bill that he wanted me to call. So we are open for business here. We have half the bills have passed. We are ready to, whenever we have the support of enough senators who are Republican. We did a very good job in getting support from a good number of the Democrats willing to vote on these tough issues. And I'm looking forward to doing this. Nothing's gotten any better. It's March. We do not have authority to spend money for higher education. That ended January 1st, remember? We do not have authority for some human services from government operations. The figure that Senator Redonio had used of $11 million a day, if that was accurate, that's still happening. So, and the effort to raise taxes starting January 1st become more difficult the further you get into the year. So, with that, I'd be happy to answer any questions. I would suggest that what you should do is ask the Senate Republicans individually what the governor did. I haven't talked to the governor. I've talked to Republican senators who said they went and saw the governor today, so you should ask them what he told them.
So, President, what are the next steps then? Is this back to four-leader meetings where the governor is involved in negotiations again? Is that how we move forward?
Well, that didn't work before. That's why we started this. Again, my attitude is I was ready to call these bills today. I had sufficient number of votes from the Democratic caucus to pass them all, assuming we had a similar percentage of votes from the Republicans. So it's not my move. I think it's really assuming that what happened here is that the governor pulled votes off. We should find out why the governor did that. Apparently he wants to change the items that were negotiated, but that's what he's been has failed to do for 2 years. This was a good exercise because you can go look at the bills. There's things there that Democrats don't want to vote for. Unions are against it. Trial lawyers are against it. But we still were willing to put votes on the board. The things that the governor asked for, he even got term limits for leaders. He's got workers' comp changes. He's got bills dealing with his property tax freeze, pension reform. He's got that. And a negotiated revenue bill with Senator Redonio supports every one of those today. So he's the leader of his party. He's the one that put $50 million into his fund as a down payment. You'll have to ask him what the next step is. I'm willing to do anything, go to meetings and the main thing is those bills are out there. They're ready to be called. We need Republican support.
He's tweeted a photo of what he wants to see out of this grand bargain. One of the things is a permanent property tax freeze. Is that a non-starter?
Yeah. We negotiated a 5-year property tax freeze, a 2-year permanent, and a 3-year by referendum. Does that sound like a compromise? Yes. That's how you pass legislation, not by going back to what he did 2 years ago, the day he got inaugurated, and given us his turnaround agenda. The status quo is that we're spending $7 or $8 billion more than we have. That's the status quo. It's not like we're not overspending. We are overspending right now because we have court orders. We have continuing appropriations. And he's the one that signed the appropriation for education when all of his Republicans had voted no. So he doesn't want to shut down the schools, doesn't want to shut down state government, doesn't want to compromise. And as a result, we're as I said in an earlier speech, we owe $12 billion. On Election Day, 2 years from now, we'll owe $24 billion. In this package, we have $1 billion, $100 million. That's in the package implicitly because we raised revenues a certain amount so that we can pay off $7 billion worth of borrowing. That's one of those standalone bills, a $7 billion borrowing so we can pay off our bills. That costs $1.1 billion in a year, and you have 7 years to pay them off. If we don't pass something this year, we probably won't pass something in the fiscal, in the election year, then we will owe $24 billion. If we're 2 years behind in paying our bills right now, we would be 4 years behind, presumably. So this has got to end, and that's what we've been saying. Senator Verdonio and I have worked together. I respect her to this day. She's the one that's stood firm. It was her idea initially to do this, to show that we can come up with a compromise. The compromise is there. The governor's got to realize that this is as good as it's going to get. Can we make some minor changes? Of course we can. We've been doing that for a month with Senate Republicans. But he's got to grow up and get this solved. He's the governor.
Do you think the governor actually wants a resolution to the budget?
I don't know. I haven't talked to him. I do. I think we got elected to balance a budget. That's what our number one goal is. He wanted to attach reforms to that obvious responsibility of passing a budget. We have attached the reforms. He says they're not enough. Okay, what's your alternative? 2 more years, no money, a junk bond status might come just as a result of us not calling this bill today. So I don't know what else to say to him. I mean, he's got to figure this out. I think he's got maybe some bad advisors. Maybe that's part of the problem.
It's been said from the beginning that Republican rank-and-file members, you know, are sick of having no budget too, you know. But if that's true, then how could it be that, you know, the governor having meetings with people just on one day on, you know, a change of opinion, you know, can sway them?
Well, your question should be directed to those Republican senators, and I would urge you to do so. I mean, you got roll calls you can look at. There's only 22 of them. I have a lot more people to talk to. So you can talk to those 22 and ask them what they were thinking.
I talked to a couple. They said they're just trying to drive a harder bargain.
Yeah. Okay.
But does there come a point where...
Well, you know what? I believe that they understand that at this point in time, it's hard to say Illinois is not competitive because of our workers' comp laws, and we're losing jobs and all that because of our workers' comp laws, when in fact the reason why we might be hurting is because we don't have a budget, because we've been downgraded. The image of the state as the one of the worst run in the state, is the only one that doesn't have a budget, that's what's hurting the jobs climate and the business climate. So I think that he's got to figure that out. I think maybe that many of the Senate Republicans have, and I think that it's not the Senate Republicans who want to drive a hard bargain. I think it's the governor told them that that's what he wants.
What changed from a few weeks ago when he was heaping praise on the Senate grand bargain, cut an ad claiming ownership of the grand bargain, and then today is working against?
Well, he's willing to compromise as long as he gets 100% of what he wants, apparently. So that's not how it works. He's never been a governor before and never been in government, and people have to press buttons. People have to vote. Believe me, it's hard for me to go around and work roll calls. You see me doing it. I got as many votes as I can on all these packages, with some of my members really upset that I even call on these bills. That's what it is. That's what you do. And he apparently doesn't have people around him that he's listening to that understand how that works. So it now has got to the point where the lack of a budget itself is what's really the problem that has to be solved. And he should be lucky he's getting any of these reforms, because what we really need to do is get a budget. And that includes some revenue. And believe me, then when you structure revenue, you implicitly have to figure out, well, do we have enough money to pay for our bills? And so, even though we're not doing the budget for next year now, we're raising revenue in anticipation of that budget. And we would be saving billions of dollars by doing this grand bargain from what we're actually spending. So we're not cutting anything by not passing a bill. And that's a fundamental thing that he has to understand. We are obligating ourselves to expenses way in excess of the revenues we have in, and that's costing us more revenue to pay off the borrowing we inevitably would have to do to pay those bills. It's that simple. So they don't have the leverage, if that's the way to answer your question, that they think they have. And that's been the problem.
Well, someone could say that the grand bargain is better than nothing, but it seems like the governor is saying, no, it's worse than nothing.
But it can't be. That's really the important point. There's no such thing as standing pat here. We're spending $7 or $8 billion more than we have coming in. And the grand bargain actually ends up in us spending less than that because we're not incurring further debt that has to be paid off. Yes, ma'am.
Property tax freeze that he wants to be permanent. Are you aware of any of his other so-called non-negotiables, and can the Senate do anything?
No. See, I never talked to him. I haven't negotiated with him. I've been negotiating with Senator Redonio. And then we get these new requests all the time, but presumably are coming from the governor. And then finally, we have no votes except for Redonio's.
And if he's not willing to make that next move that you mentioned, do you know what the Senate's next step will be?
Well, I have a package of bills out there, some of which have passed. The rest can be called whenever I'm told by the Republicans that they're ready to vote for it.
The governor has repeatedly said that his demands are, it's about short-term pain now for long-term
yeah.
gain.
What do you make of that? Maybe the first month or 6 months of his administration, he could say short-term pain. Now it's been 2 years of pain and $12 billion in debt and $24 billion if we don't do anything. And the actual potential destruction of the state's economy has already started to occur because we don't have a budget. So that's what I would say to him. And so here we are giving you an opportunity to claim, of course, that you have very substantive reforms, substantive enough that the trial lawyers and the unions are certainly against it. What else does he want? What other proof does he want? They're doing robocalls telling people to vote against the bills, the unions. So what does he want us to do? I mean, this is a very fair compromise. The very modest taxes, unfortunately, it's sorry we have to do any taxes, but because of the delay for 2 years, they had to be higher than they otherwise would have been. So it all argues for the fact that we should get this done as soon as possible, and I'm still willing to do that.
The governor paying his own Republican leader out to dry here then? You said that she came to you, wanted to work this out in the Senate.
Senator Redonio has not been left out to dry. She's the one that's standing tall. She's the one that's willing to compromise. She's been compromising. She's willing to vote for all these bills. The governor is the governor of the state, and the state is in big trouble, and he's in charge.
Speaking of that union opposition, if Republicans get back on board, how sure are you of your own caucus that you're going to have the votes on?
Well, I've been spending a lot of time working with my caucus. We've had some votes that are contested. You saw how many votes I was able to get. There's different parts of the state. There's different backgrounds. There's different people have different terms of office. All that comes into play. I know how to pass bills. I've passed more bills than I sponsored more bills than any other legislator, to my knowledge, in the history of the state. So I know how to work a bill and pass a bill. And we were ready to pass all the bills if we had our Republican partners on board. Hey, guys, I'm tired. One more question.
Message change, the messages you were getting from Leader Redonio, did that change throughout today, or did you know this was going to happen?
No. When we were working this morning on some modifications to this request for what was then a request for a 5-year property tax freeze, which is untenable for poor school districts. So we were negotiating that, and we came up with a compromise. So that stopped, and she said that there's no votes except for hers. Okay, thank you, guys.
To a bargain, as it's been called, that works for the people of Illinois. I want to compliment Senator Colton for realizing that the package was not complete and that we needed more time to digest and define what we need. As I said yesterday, Many of the provisions that we were in front of us, we support, even those who didn't support it with their yes vote. But that the package yesterday was not a package that created jobs. It wasn't a package that worked for taxpayers. And it just generally wasn't right and complete in the framework in which we began this process. And so we appreciate the fact that Senator Culleton is cognizant of that. We appreciate his efforts as well as Senator Redonio's efforts, and we look forward to continuing this dialogue and hopefully in a way that moves more quickly, coming about with a solution that works for the taxpayers and for the people of Illinois. With that, I'd be happy to respond to any questions.
What about this business of the governor calling you senators in one by one and threatening you if you voted yes?
You know, let me ask Senator McConaughey to respond to that.
I'd be happy to. First of all, I want to say that I agree with Senator Brady's assessment of kind of where we're at. And I talked to the governor this morning extensively. And just to kind of give you some framework of that, I represent one of the suburban districts. Frankly, in my district, many of the communities are in some of the highest property tax communities in the entire country. So when we talk about property tax relief, which is a very big part of this program, and if you remember back to the governor's budget address, he talked about an element of this that's very important in districts like mine, and that is we have to have parity. If we're going to raise income taxes, we also have to provide property tax relief. And we're making a lot of progress in that in that discussion. As you remember, it was a talk about permanent property tax relief for permanent property permanent income tax. So a lot of the conversation has revolved around maybe we can look at different ways to get there. So I had an opportunity to talk to the governor about that. He asked a lot of good questions. He shares that same concern about ensuring that we make good decisions for the taxpayers of Illinois. If we're going to increase taxes in one regard, we have to find relief elsewhere. And I thought that he was very engaged and very supportive. So
no threats?
No threats at all.
Well, Senator Brady just said we salute President Culleton for realizing this cake is not baked yet or something. You know, it looks like the rest of you in the Republican caucus are letting Leader Redonio run out on the field by yourself, and you folks are staying on the sidelines or the locker room.
Yeah.
How much of this is you folks, and how much is being driven by the governor saying, I don't know, we need to hold out for more?
You know, Senator Redonio is to be complimented for her leadership. No one is running out on her. She's been a leader. She has negotiated a deal, and I think she's been pivotal in this process. But I think one of the reasons that caused for the delay today was that it's not already. And I want Senator Berrickman to speak to part of that.
Sure. Thanks. You know, in fact, what is proposed as Senate Bill 1 is a monumental shift in the way in which we fund our public school systems throughout the state. This has been an important issue for the governor. It's been an important issue for our caucus, and I believe it's an important issue for our colleagues on the other side of the aisle. Here we are tonight, dinner time, and we are not yet in an agreement on a final bill on that piece. In fact, we continue to draft that legislation tonight. I believe that legislation will be shared with each of the caucuses tomorrow. And so what's important here is that we recognize that this is not yet a done deal. We need to finalize these details and these negotiations. Obviously, we want to make sure that we get it right, but we need to finish it. We need to finish those negotiations. The Senate Bill 1, the education piece, is not yet there. And so as it fits into the context of 13 pieces of legislation, this is a very important piece that needs to be complete before we take any action on the totality of those pieces of legislation. Sorry.
Let me just conclude by saying that there were three key pieces to the framework of this solution. One was that we have a balanced budget. Two was that we have property tax relief for the taxpayers of Illinois. And three was that the people who grow jobs in this state were comfortable with this package. And with that, I'd like to recognize Greg Bays, who's head of the Illinois Manufacturers Association. Greg, if you want to come forward, and if you have any questions for Greg, if you don't, that's fine. But I just wanted to recognize those are the three key principles to bringing this in for a solution. And That's what we're driving for. And every day that we negotiate, we get closer and closer to that.
What specifically is the holdup now? I mean, it seems like you could go on endlessly, and Democrats say no permanent property tax freeze. Right? There's always going to be something that we didn't quite get what we wanted, maybe they didn't get what they wanted.
The holdup is we've just described a number of specific issues that we are still working out the details on. You think about the amount of various issues that we are taking on in a comprehensive package, it is no wonder that it takes a while to get there. I think we're very close. I think we're very close indeed. But I think that there are some key issues. Senator Berkman talked about education. I talked about property tax relief. We do have a balanced budget that everybody in the state of Illinois cares about. Making sure that businesses want to stay in Illinois and come to Illinois is an important part of the commitment we've made to getting the right deal. It takes time. So it's not evidence that anybody's walking away or that the governor's been heavy-handed with us. We know what we need to get for the districts that we represent, and that's we're working with our leader and with Cullerton and the Democrats to resolve those differences. That's what the give and take of this process is all about.
President Cullerton suggested earlier that the ball is in the governor's court. How does your caucus want input from him at this point? I mean, how much do you want him at this table?
Well, the governor is the chief elected official of the state of Illinois. And at the end of the day, he needs to be involved. We've welcomed always the governor's input, and we continue to seek his advice on this, and we will work with him and Senator Cullerton. But we believe that a key to this framework is to continue to work with the Senate Democrats and Senate Republicans to craft this solution. There's no question in our mind that the governor's input is valuable.
Leader Redonia was apparently willing to vote yes on everything today. Are you saying that she's ceded too much ground to Democrats in the name of, you know, getting this done?
Don't answer for her.
I don't know what your question was.
She's the only yes vote on any of this.
No, I mean the leader made a statement today. I think none of us can speak for the leader, but I think we're here tonight supporting our leader and emphasizing the fact that there tonight is not yet a deal that should or can be voted on. I gave you the example, the education piece, not yet final, and that it's our belief, and I think the belief of members of our caucus, that we need to put forward a comprehensive set of 13 bills that are a good bargain for taxpayers, that include a balanced budget, and allow our state to take that important step forward here. And that's what we're committed to doing.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Don Harmon, the President Pro Tem of the Senate, Democrat from Oak Park. A handful of us, Senator Andy Menar, Senator Heather Staines, and hopefully we'll be joined by Senator Toy Hutchinson, wanted to be available following the last press conference. We understand that we did not hear all that they had to say, but we certainly understood that they were trying to reframe what happened this afternoon in a light more favorable to them. But we're here to say that Democrats put on the table a comprehensive compromise package that would lead to a balanced budget, a grand compromise, and we stand behind that work. Democrats were willing today to vote for it, and the Republicans walked away. I didn't hear whether or not the Republicans denied the reports that the governor or his office called them in today and threatened them. I'd be interested in knowing how they recharacterized that today, but that's certainly the direct reports that we've gotten from our Republican colleagues. I'm going to turn it over to Heather Staines. Heather, you want to go first?
This has been a lot like Lucy and the football, keep pulling it up. There's been a number of times now, as you guys in the media know, that we've been ready in the Senate Dems to actually put votes on the compromise, and they keep coming back, the Republicans, with more that they want. This originally had all started as a real agreement in the Senate. It was Leader Redonia, who I have great respect for what she's been doing and how much of a difficult time she's been getting by a lot of people for doing it, coming in and really working with the Senate President to get to an agreement. They have been working countless hours in doing it. Every time we think we're ready to do a vote, they come back in with something more they want. I think what's happened is that the governor's been clearly injecting himself into these negotiations. And really today, I believe we have real evidence that he undermined and killed this today. I had heard directly from some of my Republican colleagues this morning that there was just one thing they needed after having met with the governor last night and the whole group. We worked today and had an agreement that the Senate president worked out on those agreements that they wanted. The one item to get to that agreement, we understood. We thought then everything was fine. All of a sudden, it came up to something else you wanted. This has been the ongoing scenario of what's been happening, is every time you get there, they keep moving the goal line. And the governor doesn't know how to actually get us out of this. It's clear he doesn't want it to pass, or he wouldn't be working so hard to undermine it with the colleagues. And quite frankly, I think the Republicans at some point need to stand up and be willing to step aside from the governor and say, we need to end this for the state. Every day that goes by, we're adding $11 million into unpaid bills. We're well over $12 billion right now. We are literally decimating the infrastructure across the state for human services, for our higher education universities, for all sorts of the domestic violence are getting no funded. They're having to close down. Item after item of things that are getting seriously hurt. And instead of actually helping us get something on the board to yes, the governor keeps killing it every time we're close. I'm tired of the games that's getting played here and think it's really been doing a detrimental service to the state of Illinois.
Andy Menard, 48th District. Let me begin by also being complimentary to Leader Redonio for her sincerity and her work with the Senate Republican Caucus, along with our leader, President Cullerton. They started down this path a few months ago, as everybody knows. The grand bargain bills were filed, I believe, on January 11th. Was the first look that we got at what their work produced. And I think that, from my perspective, was a good move on their part. Today, though, what happened, I think, is a complete reversal of what both leaders set out to do on January 11th when they filed the set of bills that are pending today in the state Senate. Everybody knows that we've taken great efforts and many meetings and countless hours to get a school funding bill to a point to where we can achieve a bipartisan majority. And I think the work that I took part in over the last couple of weeks is indicative of what we saw today spell out in the state Senate. So I'll tell you a quick little story. Wednesday mornings in the Menard House is bacon and eggs. So I made bacon and eggs, and I got in my car, and I drove to Springfield with the absolute belief that there was a bipartisan agreement on school funding. Absolute belief that there was a bipartisan agreement on school funding. The only thing that changed between the time that I left my son eating his bacon and eggs and got here in Springfield and was given the news that there is not a bipartisan agreement on school funding is the element of Bruce Rauner being injected into the conversation. That is the only thing that changed in the state Senate today when it came to Senate Bill 1. I believe that this is a difficult issue, along with workers' comp, along with the spending bill, along with the other things that are part of this package. School funding is as difficult as any of them. They're all difficult. And I believe that the Senate Republicans wanted to have an agreement so that we could have a bipartisan vote. That work was complete. The only difference today was that Bruce Rauner began to pick up the phone and call members of the Senate Republican Caucus. Absent of that, I believe we would be standing here today with a package of bills that would have been advanced out of the Senate.
Absolutely.
Well, Senators, I believe the yolk's on you. Sorry. I think the governor
Light move, room, thank you.
Dave, you already got me once today. So.
He would say, oh, no, I'm not changing the rules at all. I wanted a permanent property tax freeze all along. I've been talking about that for 3 years. I haven't changed my way on that at all. A permanent property tax freeze is what it's about. And President Cullerton made it sound like that was the sticking point, and it's not a new tack from the governor, if indeed that's what he said.
The governor must not understand the legislative process or compromise. The end of the day is not you get everything you wanted. The end of the day is you compromise and you get some of what you wanted. A two-year property tax freeze is a significant accomplishment, but the governor doesn't know how to declare victory. This is a package. There are items in these packages that none of us want to vote for because we don't like them. We wouldn't have initiated them. We're not thrilled that they're in them. But we're prepared to take difficult votes to advance the interests of the state to pass a balanced budget. The governor has no willingness to do the same. He will not relinquish these priorities that he's put in his own head that don't have the votes in the Senate or the House to pass. He's got to understand the political and legislative realities here.
So, Don, what are you going to do now? Are you going to go back to the bargaining table, or are you just going to walk away, or what are you going to do now?
We've set the ceiling in terms of what the Senate Democratic Caucus is willing to do. We've gone far beyond where we thought we could go to try to reach a compromise in the middle ground. That offer, as I understand it, remains on the table, but with each passing minute, it's more difficult for us to maintain our majorities. I don't know what else we can do other than sit back as Democrats and try to come up with a proposal that we can advance without the support of our Republican colleagues, because they're clearly missing in action at the behest of the governor.
What did the Republicans report the governor had threatened them with?
They did not report the substance of those threats, but I think all of us can validate that we've heard firsthand from Republican colleagues that the governor was calling people in and chastising them for their votes yesterday in some cases and threatening them in as to future votes.
Can you disclose who those Republicans were that received those calls?
You've heard from them, and you could certainly ask them.
So you're saying that at least one of the people that was in the room just a few minutes ago might have been one of them?
I would certainly ask the three of them what their experience was like or whether they have any firsthand knowledge.
Heather, you said that they asked for one more thing and you gave it to them. What was it?
The one more thing had been exactly on the property tax and the income tax. And there was a further negotiation today between Leader Redonio and Senate President where they got to an agreement on that issue. And then yet there was something else. So we really went into caucus, I think all of us, until we entered caucus today believing that we'd actually gotten to a bipartisan agreement and we were going to be going out on the floor and voting. This has happened to us before. Only when we got in there did we hear that he'd added something else, which I had confirmed to me directly by one of my Republican colleagues. This is continuing on. So at this point, I don't know how you negotiate somebody who keeps moving the end lines. And that's clearly the governor who's done that. It was sort of nebulous about the budget agreement. I would want you to talk to them to get the specifics, since it wasn't me who heard that directly from him. But it was a new issue that we had not yet heard before. So it's not something you've reported yet on Capital Facts. That's my point, is keep moving the goal lines.
They said this afternoon, evening, whatever, that there was an GOMB believes there was an $800 million deficit.
Who does GOMB work for?
Yeah, and where is that coming from exactly? And did the Senate Republicans ever express that interest? Yeah. I mean,
you asked for a meeting with GOMB, they sat down with staff, they went to it, GOMB says it's an $800 million hole.
So I would suggest to you then that they are then coming back with other requests. Maybe that happened today. I don't know. I can tell you we've been negotiating every day with these folks, and that's not come up until today.
And I would say this, Rich. It would be nice if GOMB held the governor's budget to the same standards that they're holding this budget.
Good.
Because it's clearly two different standards. And I'll give you my own experience about moving the goalpost. We were armed with a report from the governor's commission, his commission on school funding, that he constituted, that produced a bipartisan report that was very specific in some places, a little squishy in other places. We crafted a bill that I think is reflective of that report. We negotiated pieces of it. As you know, it's very intricate and every word matters in school funding bills. But we got to a point last week where we thought we were done. And then the weekend goes by. And Monday comes along. And there's another list of things that have to be added to that bill in order to gain bipartisan votes, which is what our goal is in the Senate, to try to wrestle this logjam loose. And I'm not opposed to continuing to negotiate the issue, right? But what I am opposed to is this constant merry-go-round of chasing the same issues over and over again just a week later, asking for the same thing. Things that were not even in the governor's commission's report on school funding are being demanded to be put into a bill. That's what we're dealing with here. And when there's an agreement between two caucuses, and those agreements, and everybody knows it's not done till a bill's passed. Everybody knows that. But when those agreements become threatened because of one person's actions, one person in the state, there's 13 million people in Illinois, and millions right now are suffering because we don't have a budget in place. One person injected himself into this conversation today. And that's why we're not standing here talking about how we really get this job done with a balanced and sustainable budget.
Let's let Senator Hutchins sit up.
Hi, everybody. I think the level of frustration that we see right now is that we heard from Leader Redonio today that every day that we go by is $11 million. And in my experience, the whole time I've been in the Senate, and for all of the conversations we've heard about Democratic governors, that's normally referred to as gross fiscal mismanagement. But right now, it's just $11 million a day. Now, I'm carrying Senate Bill 9, which is the revenue package that very, very many people don't like. It's the hard part of what it takes to get a budget. And we have gone through so many iterations of what's in this budget. I mean, what's in the revenue package. Literally, they change daily. And then we think we have something, and then the next night, that goes away. And then the next night, that goes away. Now, I'm the first one to admit that taxes are a very difficult subject. I'm also the first one to admit that you can't talk about taxes without what they pay for. So any of us that stand up and talk about the things that we say we care about, if we're talking about school funding, if we're talking about our social service safety net, if we're talking about the hundreds of thousands and millions of people across this state that have lost services, who are continually bombarded with there are not enough cuts, and then we give more cuts, and they say, well, maybe you cut too much, or what this revenue package is finally going to be like. It has just been, it's just been amazing to me in a room where the goalposts constantly move. So right now, I think what we've always indicated is that we're ready to be partners in this, because we can't continue acting as though the governor is not Republican, and the Republican governor cannot continue to act as though this isn't a democratically led legislature. There is nothing any of us can do alone. Nothing. But it's $11 million a day. Yesterday was a really good day. It was a good day because we actually put some votes up on the board and showed that there are people who are willing to take bipartisan votes, and some of them were hard. And at the end of the day, this package is not anything that I would have done on my own. It's not anything that most of us would have done on our own, because that's not necessarily, they're not always based on democratic principles. But the one thing we don't want to do is continue to make the same political mistakes we've made every single year since then. It's like, at some point, we have to realize that winning elections is easy. Governing is hard. It's really hard. And we cannot do it alone. So if we want to change the conversation, we want to change the narrative, we want to actually show that Illinois is open for business, then it's time to put the votes where all the rhetoric has been. This is not the final thing. Last time I checked, there's two chambers. It needs to leave the Senate so that it can go be debated in the House. But if we cannot get it out of the Senate, then we are literally running down the clock and admitting that it's okay with people to not have a budget until 2018. And that is just unconscionable. It's just unconscionable.
I'm worried, are you folks, about the public relations piece of the governor's elevator speech and saying, hey, I want to put a lid on your property taxes. Those of us who open a property tax bill, that's not a fun day for anybody. And it's really easy to understand, I don't want to pay more property taxes. And you know, and if you say it enough times, it sounds easy. And it's the more times you say it, the better it sounds. What you guys are saying doesn't fit into an elevator, you know, unless it's a Sears Tower. How worried are you about people in Illinois, the 13 million, really understanding it and seeing it, at least if not your way, for the nuanced thing that it is?
Well, there is a simple way to say that one of the reasons why the property taxes are as high as they are is because 60 to 70% of your property tax bill goes to school funding. And because the state doesn't take care of its responsibility in terms of school funding, then we are left with this situation where the burden falls on our local property taxpayers. So it's amazing to me that people take the easy way out of just simply saying, I don't want to pay any more property taxes, because of course that's how we feel. But you also can't say on the other side that you don't care about funding schools. The way to take care of property taxes is to handle school funding. Now, we have some very poor school districts across the state. And the thing that is so hurtful to those of us who have schools that are in deficit spending, and nearly 40% of our schools are in deficit spending, is that we have people in wealthy districts with schools flush with reserves behaving as though it's just fine for us to hurt those poor school districts even more. At some point, we need to be thinking about these kids as though they're all our kids, not just the ones in our individual districts, but that they're all our children. And that Illinois is not going to have a properly funded school system until we take responsibility for all of our children. The easy things have been done already. The hard stuff is what's left. That's why it doesn't fit into an elevator.
But isn't, and I want to ask Senator to stay, walking away because you believe that he pulled the rug out from under you one more time, and doing what Senator Harmon suggested a little earlier, maybe running your own package, you know, with Democratic principles, and forget about it, you're not going to get Republican votes anyway. But even if you pass that, and even if the House picked it up and passed it, the dude's going to veto it. The governor's going to veto it. And then where are you? So, while you have always been a very patient person, you appear to have lost it.
You're reading my body language well, Rich. My husband doesn't like it either when it happens.
But I guess what I'm asking is, maybe the Republican he talked to was right. They are the only game in town. And maybe you just got to swallow again and go back and try to get another bill. Because if you go off and just do a press pop bill for Democratic principles, it ain't going anywhere.
So I believe we're going to file what we thought the agreement was, all the various amendments, and we're going to file that so everyone can see what it was, and that we did, in fact, make additional changes today to get to what we were told. I know I was to my, in person from Republican colleagues, was the one more thing that was needed, and we negotiated around that to get there. You know, my elevator speech is, Governor, do your job. I mean, we have been without a budget since he's been here. I don't know how you live with good conscience and go to sleep at night with devastating the state the way you are. Truly, I don't. That's why I've tried to be patient, because I feel so strongly that we need to be standing up and doing the right thing for the people of Illinois. Right now, it is a self-made problem that has been generated in Illinois. We've been doing it to ourselves, our politicians. You wonder why we're so unliked right now. I've never seen numbers the way you have until, and it's everybody. The state of Illinois, the people in Illinois, you poll them, they don't like Republicans, they don't like Dems, they don't like any of us, nor should they, because we're not doing our job, and it all starts with a leader. The governor is not doing his job and not getting a budget. Instead, when you finally have the Senate stepping up and negotiating in very good faith to do that, he interjects himself to make sure we don't actually get it done and up on the board and voted. We did have an agreement, I believe. We all thought we were going in there to vote, and yet once again, there's something else he adds, and the reason you're seeing this is, you know, there's only so many times you can have any faith that you have a trustworthy negotiating partner when they continue to pull up the football. It's just, I literally had people telling me we were good to go if we got this. We got it. I assume we're good to go, and yet again, they pull the football. I think we have it out there. I'm hoping that the Republicans will come back and say, yes, we're going to be willing to put some votes on this. We're never going to walk away. It's too important to the state of Illinois. I'm not suggesting that. I am suggesting that you can't negotiate like this. I'd love you to go and ask the Republicans, if we were going and talking to the House, how would they like that? That was never the deal. We were working here, Senate Republicans, Senate Dems, on an agreement. And it's time to actually stand up and actually put some votes on this. You know, I think we've been operating in very good faith and have never been the ones walking away from the table in any of this. And I do think that, you know, every day that goes by is another horrible day for the state of Illinois, and many people are actually feeling the pain on it. And it's unfortunately not enough of us in this Capitol are feeling that pain, and we need to start feeling some pain from folks, or maybe we'll never get this done.
The easy way to say no down here is to say, oh, just one more thing. We're done pretending just one more thing means just one more thing. The governor and the Republicans said no. They've been saying no for weeks and weeks. I don't know how many times we've stood up on the floor and said, we're not going to vote today. We'll vote next week. It's always one more thing. One more thing means no, and that's the message we heard loud and clear today.
Does that mean that your last and best final offer now, this is no more compromising, reached your capacity?
We have stretched and stretched. I think, as Senator Staines mentioned, we're going to file these amendments today that reflect what we understood the agreement to be. I think we'd be hard-pressed to move beyond that in any way, shape, or form.
Next, from Springfield, we head to the Senate floor to hear the debate over the grand bargain budget deal, which was composed of 16 different bills. This runs about 40 minutes.
To proceed, Mr. Secretary, please read the bill.
Senate Bill 7, an act concerning gaming, third reading of the bill.
Senator Link to explain.
Thank you, Mr. President. This is a comprehensive gaming bill that creates six new riverboats in Chicago, Rockford, Danville, south suburbs of Cook, Lake County, and unincorporated Williamson County. This bill also establishes the Chicago Casino Development Authority and a five-member Chicago Casino Development Board to oversee the development and promotion of the new Chicago casino. However, the Illinois Gaming Board still maintains a regulatory authority over the Chicago casino. This bill allows Chicago to have up 4,000 positions. Also, this will allow new and existing casinos may have up to 1,600 gaming positions. However, casinos may purchase up to 2,000 unused positions for other casinos. This bill also allows electronic gaming at racetracks. When the Chicago casinos begin operating, a privilege tax on casinos and electronic gaming will be decreased. Senate Bill 7 also adds a significant ethics provision for members of the Chicago Casino Development Board, the Illinois Racing Board, and the Illinois Gaming Board. The bill requires the establishment of diversity programs to increase the utilization of minority and female-owned businesses. Finally, Senate Bill 7 makes various changes to promote standardbred racing and improve the efficiency of the Illinois Gaming Board's application process. Be more than happy to answer any questions.
Is there any discussion? Senator Severson.
Thank you, Mr. President. First to the bill and maybe a question. First, I want to thank Senator Link for his years of work on this. We have passed this bill a number of times out of here, and appreciate your work and your willingness to work with this side and in compromising and coming up with a bill that really addresses a lot of concerns for a lot of individuals, but also addresses the issues that we've been concerned about, which is we're surrounded by five states that have all declared war on Illinois, and they are building casinos on their borders. And if I'm not mistaken, last year about $1.6 billion left Illinois just to go to the five surrounding states. $1.6 billion just to our surrounding states. And if you go into Indiana and look at some of their casinos, you'll see the majority of the cars there are have Illinois plates in those. This is a bill that helps keep our entertainment dollars here in Illinois. Second is for Chicago. To be a tourist and a convention center like Chicago is, not to have a casino makes no sense. It would be a significant help to the city of Chicago, to their financial concerns, but also it's going to help them attract more conventions. It's going to help keep those dollars, again, in Chicago, which makes this an important bill. And then third, this helps communities all around the state that are struggling, communities that are on border communities that are struggling, like Rockford and in Lake County and Danville, those communities that have neighboring states literally minutes away that are developing casinos that would devastate communities like ours in Rockford. The amount of construction that this brings, the amount of jobs that this creates is significant for Illinois. And again, these are dollars that are now currently leaving Illinois that we're talking about keeping here in this state. So I stand, rise in support of this legislation. We have tried to address the concerns of from horsemen to local communities, to existing casinos, to the new ones, and I think we've tried to address it in this legislation. So, again, Senator, thank you for your leadership on this, and I hope we can get this part of this grand bargain passed, so we can have at least this out of the way as we work on the rest of the program. So, thank you.
Senator McCarter, for what purposes do you seek recognition?
Bill, to the bill, please.
Bill, Senator McCarter.
You know, getting in shape physically is a difficult thing. But you know, there's always a late night gadget that you can strap around your waist and shock yourself or whatever it is to, if you believe it's gonna really work. But the truth is, you got to get up every day, and you got to eat a little less and work hard, and that's how it happens. This is not the fix for Illinois. And, you know, it's a little embarrassing that instead of doing the hard work of disciplining ourselves to lower our spending and reduce the size of this government that's unaffordable to the people, we look to solutions like this. We hear we need to grow our way out of this mess, but instead we're going to gamble our way out of this mess. This is wrong. You know, we need to make those tough choices and be honest with people as to much how much we can do for them, how much money we can spend. And I think that those things that are coming in the future, besides just gambling, but a tax increase, which again is attached to this bill as well, would go over a lot better if people saw that we were making an effort to live within our means first, just as they are required to in their families and at their home. Gambling, video poker, video gaming, medical marijuana, it's unfortunate that this is the only thing that we have to offer to get our house in order rather than being disciplined in our spending. I urge a no vote.
Senator Link to close.
Thank you, Mr. President. I've been thinking a lot about this bill. Senator Severson said I've introduced it, passed it numerous amount of times. People might have criticism of gaming in the state of Illinois. First of all, no one's forcing you to gamble. This is a recreational objective that people can go to if they so see fit to. And Illinois has taken an opportunity to expand to help six different local communities. I'll use Chicago as the first example. When they're going to use their profits from this to pay police and fire pensions, I have heard it from that side and this side from people complaining, why do we have to give more general revenue funds to the city of Chicago to pay for their police and fire pension? Well, guess what? Pass this bill and you won't have to worry about that in the future. The other thing, I'd like you to go to Danville, Rockford, up in Lake County, south suburbs, and tell those people that we don't want to have jobs and opportunities for people to strive in the future. I mean, when you talk to a person that's looking for a job and you're telling them, well, we could create a job, but it's probably not going to help you because it's part of gaming. It'll help them, and you talk to the communities that have gaming in it and see how they have strived in the future. I won't belabor this point, but I do want to say one thing. There is one business I want to put out of business, and that's the busing companies that are taking people to Indiana and Wisconsin every day. And if you don't think that they are taking them, Look at the size of those buses, and they're not running empty. They're taking people other states. They're taking our money from this state. And as Senator Severson said, I think we could use $1.6 billion in this state. I ask for affirmative vote on this. Thank you.
The question is, shall Senate Bill 7 pass? All those in favor will vote aye, opposed nay. The voting is open. Have all voted who wish. Take the record. There are 31 voting yea, 26 voting nay, none voting present. Senate Bill 7, having received the required constitutional majority, is declared passed. Senator Culleton wishes to proceed on Senate Bill 16. Yeah, President Culleton, I'm sorry. President Culleton. Senator President Culleton seeks leave of the body to return Senate Bill 16 to the order of second reading. Leave is granted. On the order of second reading, Senate Bill 16, Mr. Secretary, are there any floor amendments approved for consideration? Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye, opposed nay. The ayes have it, and the amendment is adopted. Are there any further floor amendments approved for consideration?
Floor amendment number 2 offered by President Culleton.
Senator Culleton to explain.
Yes, amendment number 2 is the technical amendment that links this bill with the other bills in the package, so move for its adoption.
Is there any discussion? All those in favor will say aye, opposed nay. The ayes have it, and the amendment is adopted. Are there any further floor amendments approved for consideration?
No further amendments reported.
Third reading. Now on the order of third reading, Senator Culleton, President Culleton indicates that he wishes to proceed. Mr. Secretary, please read the bill.
Senate Bill 16, an act concerning state government, third reading of the bill.
Senator Culleton to explain.
Yes, thank you, Mr. President. This bill was debated earlier, but there's been some changes. And I want to highlight those changes by addressing concerns that have been raised. I understand, first of all, there might be some concerns by some Republicans in the chamber concerning the governor's position on this bill. So first of all, I would remind you that when we had our State of the State message, the governor personally expressed his congratulations to myself and to Leader Redonio for our efforts here. Our efforts to try, and I could quote him, by working together, trying to find solutions, trying to find compromise. And this is a perfect example in this bill of my effort to try to find compromise with the governor. And so we have added language to the bill that I got from the governor. It's called a Tier 3 plan. So that in this pension bill, newly hired employees at SCRS, SURS, and TRS would have the option to be shifted to a hybrid plan that has a defined contribution component, and for those employees who do not participate in Social Security, a defined benefit component. And of course, you'd have the option to stay in your Tier 2. Also, the plan provides a local option which would allow other units of government to choose by ordinance to offer a similar type. I got this language from the governor. Earlier, in the earlier effort to put this bill together, the governor's office also gave me a number of other changes. The investment return smoothing. This bill phases in over a 5-year period any changes in actuarial or investment return assumptions made by the pension system. Another change, optional defined contribution plan. It creates a defined contribution plan in each system, allowing up to 5% of Tier 1 employees to join that plan in lieu of continued participation in the defined benefit plan. Anti-salary spiking. For SURS and TRS, if a member receives a pay increase of more than CPI during the 4-year period used to calculate their pension, then their employer will be responsible for increasing the pension cost. Another change that I got from the governor, salary in excess of the governor's. For SURS and TRS employers, They will be responsible for making a pension contribution for employees whose salary exceeds that of the governor. So I have listened to the governor and we have made these changes, but more importantly, the governor also, after many hours, quite frankly, of talking about pensions with his staff, he agreed that our consideration model is the one that has the best chance of being found constitutional, and it would save the money. And so over a year ago, he and I came to that agreement. He was a little frustrated because he wanted me to introduce the bill right away. Where's your bill? Come on, let's go, let's get it. And I told him that it would probably be better if it was part of a package. And that's where we are today. Now, for some of my own colleagues, there's been some opposition that has come from some unions saying that they're opposed to this. So I just have to give you a little bit of background. With all due respect, I spent hours, hundreds of hours, could have been, with 10 or 12 meetings with the unions a number of years ago to bring about a pension reform bill. And it was based on the same consideration model. And they supported it. They said it was constitutional. We passed it with over, I think, 40 votes. It never got called in the House. And this version of that same constitutional provision called the consideration model is even less onerous, if you will, to those people who it affects. So what's really critical is for people to understand, and I believe this, that if you're working for the government and your employer says, we're going to give you a pay raise, but it's not going to be part of your final pension calculation, they have the right to do that. And that's critical to understanding what this bill does. So here's what we're saying to all the people who haven't been hired in the last 5 years. That's about 25% of our workforce. These are people who have a tier one, what we call a tier one pension. Here's what we're telling them. We're going to give you three things. If you give up your 3% compounded COLA that you have right now, that you might get 30, 35 years from now, if you agree to give that up, and take a tier two COLA, the same one that everybody else has who's been hired the last 5 years, we're going to give you three things. We're going to give you 10% back of everything you've contributed so far. We're going to lower your future contributions by 10%, and we're going to guarantee you that all your pay raises for the rest of your career are going to be guaranteed as part of your final COLA. That's actually a pretty good deal. And then when we save that $1 billion a year that this bill saves, we would have the option to appropriate that money right back into the school system. So there'll be an immediate benefit for those schools, and immediate benefit for that teacher who's going to get a pay raise, they're going to get a lump sum check, and a guarantee that in the future their pay raises will be pensionable. That's what the bill is. And I think if the people who are in the system understand that as to what that bill does, they'll think that maybe this isn't such a bad idea. And so I appreciate working with the governor on this bill. I've heard some talk about people voting no on individual parts of this package. I don't understand that. If you don't like a bill that's in the package, vote no. If you like a bill that's in the package, vote yes. It's not that complicated. Sure, if one of them doesn't pass, they all fail. You would win then if that's what you wanted to do, but why would you vote no on a good bill like this that embodies the best in compromising? Even though there's opposition, this is something which is a tough vote, but it's an important vote. So, I'd be happy to answer any questions, and I ask for an aye vote.
Senator Anderson, for what purpose do you seek recognition?
To the bill, Mr. President.
To the bill.
I would just like to commend everybody on this whole package, but I would like the record to show on this bill alone that this could be considered a conflict of interest for myself. So I will be voting present. Thank you.
Senator Ryder, for what purpose do you seek recognition?
To the bill, if I might, Mr. President. To the bill.
The bill, Senator Ryder.
Thank you very much, Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen of the Senate. I want to follow up a little bit on some of the Senate President's comments with regards to this legislation. And I appreciate that there are those who see any one bill, voting for any one of these bills as a vote in favor of all of them. And then there are others who think that some are good and some are bad, and so you vote for the ones that you like or good policy, and you vote against the ones you think otherwise. I have never voted for a major pension reform bill in my time in the Senate. Never. Either because those bills, in my view, were either inequitable or they were unconstitutional. I am going to vote for this one. And now, having said that, I'm going to disagree with the Senate President with regards to what's known as the offer and consideration portion of this bill. I think that the offer and consideration portion is clearly unconstitutional. Offer and consideration implies that you're going to give me something, you choose what you want to give me, and I'm going to give you something you don't have. That's not what this does. This says you're entitled to two things, you give me one of them. That's not consideration. There may be an offer in there, but there's no consideration. Now, having said that, there is, my understanding, a severability clause in the bill so that we know that even if the offer and consideration provisions in the bill are deemed unconstitutional, the other provisions will still survive. And I hope that in his closing, I'm going to ask the Senate President to reemphasize the importance of the severability clause so that any judge down the road reading these comments will see clearly it is the sponsor's intent that the rest of the bill become law, even if the offer and consideration portion is deemed unconstitutional. The reason I'm voting for the rest of the package is because it is beyond time. I appreciate that. It is beyond time to start moving in this direction. This legislation has provisions in it that move us toward a defined contribution model. And ladies and gentlemen, as often, government is running behind the rest of the civilized world when it comes to issues, and this is a good example of that. Most of private industry and much of government now is moving in the direction of telling its employees, you put something in, we'll put something in, and within certain parameters, you'll be allowed to management and you live with it. That provides for more predictability for the employees, it provides for more predictability for the taxpayers, and having that kind of model will do something that I think that sometimes we forget about in here, and that is, it will not allow the state of Illinois to do what it's done for so many years and say, you know what, we're not going to pay our share. We're just not going to do that, because federal law won't allow us to do that. So I want to and support the legislation. I have deep reservations about the offer and consideration. The rest of this bill, though, is exactly the direction in which we need to head. Thank you, Mr. President.
Senator President Cullerton to close.
Yes, thank you, Mr. President. I appreciate the discussion about the constitutionality. I would tell you that issue that was raised by Senator Ryder turns on the question as to whether or not future pay raises are guaranteed by the Constitution, even though you haven't been offered them yet, whether they're guaranteed to be part of your final pensionable salary. That's what it turns on. I believe that they do not. And therefore, you are getting something. You're getting a guarantee that all your pay raises in the future will, that employer cannot condition that pay raise. So there is consideration, and the courts don't question the sufficiency of the consideration, just whether there's any consideration. And so that's why I believe it's constitutional, and the senator's right, there's a severability clause in the Constitution. So we come back to it. This is a really important bill. We have to, I didn't mention, it also abolishes the future members of the General Assembly from having a pension. Some people are upset that that's in there, but quite frankly, a lot of the new members that have been elected are turning down their pension. It doesn't apply to current members, but that's in the bill as well. So we have worked very hard on this bill. These are not easy things to pass. We've passed unconstitutional pension bills before. Believe me, I know what one looks like. We did it before. This one is constitutional, and I would ask you to please consider voting for it. Thank you.
The question is, shall Senate Bill 16 pass? All those in favor will vote aye. Opposed, nay. The voting is open. Have all voted who wish? Have all voted who wish? Have all voted who wish? Take the record. There are 26 voting yay, 27 voting nay, 2 voting present. Senate Bill 16 has not received the constitutional majority and is declared failed. President Cullerton.
Postpone consideration, please.
The Senator moves for postponed consideration. Ms. Secretary, put it on postponed consideration. President Cullerton wishes to proceed on Senate Bill 5. President Cullerton seeks leave of the body to return Senate Bill 5 to the order of second reading. Leave is granted. On the order of second reading is Senate Bill 5. Mr. Secretary, are there any floor amendments? Are there any floor amendments approved for consideration?
Floor amendment number 1, offered by President Cullerton.
President Cullerton to explain.
Yes, thank you, Mr. President, members of the Senate. This is a bill that we have passed out of the Senate in a bipartisan fashion, actually, a number of times. I think people are pretty much familiar with it. It's called Pension Parity for the Chicago Public School Teacher Pensions. Beginning in fiscal year 2017, the state will assume the employer normal cost for the Chicago teachers. Currently, the state pays the normal cost and the unfunded liability of the downstate teachers' pension system. In fiscal year 2017, this would be $215 million. In fiscal year 2018, it would be $221 million. And thereafter, it would be certified by the board, just like we do with the TRS. So I think people know what it is. It would be the same continuing appropriation that we have for the TRS. I'd be happy to answer any questions and ask for an aye vote.
Is there any discussion on the amendment? Senator Rooney, for what purpose do you seek recognition?
To the bill, Mr. President.
This is to the amendment. This is to the amendment, not the bill.
Sorry.
Seeing no discussion, all those in favor will say aye, opposed, nay. The ayes have it, and the amendment has been adopted. Are there any further floor amendments approved for consideration?
No further amendments reported.
Third reading. Now the word of third reading, President Cullerton indicates that he wishes to proceed. Mr. Secretary, please read the bill.
Senate Bill 5, an act concerning public employee benefits, third reading of the bill.
Senator Cullerton to explain.
Yes, thank you, Mr. President. I certainly hope that we will be able to pass the pension bill that's on postponed consideration so that it would be tied to this pension parity bill as well. And again, I would renew my argument that this is something which should be equitable for the city of Chicago. That's already something that's being paid to the rest of the state. It would help the city avoid some of the proposed either layoffs or shortage of school days that they're contemplating in light of the fact that they don't have this money. So, again, please ask for an aye vote. Be happy to answer any questions.
Is there any discussion? Senator Rooney.
Thank you, Mr. President, to the bill, as long as I'm not messing it up now. I freely admit I'm feeling a little discombobulated over here because I'm voting no on a lot of things today that I would like to vote yes for. This little mechanism of having all these bills tied together has tied my hands. And so I've got a sea of red going up today because there are two bills.
quite frankly, the good work done by my leader and by President Cullerton has put together 11 votes that I would have loved to have taken in the green. But the revenue bill is one that I can't support, and this is the other one, which is why I feel the need to rise. I'm not a Chicago basher. I think we all do better with a healthy Chicago. I'm not a Chicago public schools basher. I think we all do better with Chicago healthy schools. But I'm one of the people where if the principal is strong enough, you let it get in the way of the practicality of, hey, you got to give a little something, we got to give a little something. And the principle here is just too important. Pensions, by their definition, are the longest term thing that we deal with. They are not the hokey pokey where you get to put your right hand in and then take it out and then put it back in. This problem that we're trying to solve with this measure got started about 20 years ago at the request of the Chicago Public School System. They said, hey, we want to get out of this. We want to be treated differently. Well, I'm sorry. As much as I'd like to help, when you make a decision like that, when you take your right hand out, your right hand is out. And when you pick up one end of a stick, you pick up the other end with it, and you have to take the consequences. And so this one here, I just can't support with what I teach kids about. You don't get to say, we want to be treated differently, and then when you want to get the same money that everybody else has, call it parity. I actually object to the use of that word because nobody else got the flexibility that Chicago Public Schools got 20 years ago, but now we all have to pay in for parity to get things back. When you make a decision, sometimes the consequences are things you have to stick with. And so this is one of the two that I actually firmly would be a no on and keep me from being a yes on a lot of good stuff that I wish I could vote for.
Any further discussion? Seeing none, Senator Cullerton to close on the hokey pokey.
Well, thank you. So I appreciate Senator Rooney's comments. I believe that given some time, I can, since you're relatively new here, I can go back and show that that's an inaccurate representation on this particular issue of the history of what happened. I do acknowledge that this issue is frequently tied to a concern about the school funding formula, which is another bill which we hope we will be able to resolve. So, but I think the history of pension, the normal cost being paid for by the state, is that the Chicago Teachers Union, which I believe was started in 1896, never got a state appropriation sending paying their normal cost. Unlike the TRS, which whenever that was started, that automatically got the state to be the employer and to pay the normal cost. But that being said, I appreciate the fact that there is an issue with regard to this this bill. It's controversial. It has been in some quarters. But I think in light of the fact that we're going to work on pension reform as well as the school funding reform, that this will be an appropriate bill to vote for. So please vote aye.
The question is, shall Senate Bill 5 pass? All those in favor will vote aye, opposed nay. The voting is open. Have all voted who wish? Have all voted who wish? Have all voted who wish? Take the record. There are 35 voting yea, 22 voting nay, 1 voting present. Senate Bill 5, having received the constitutional majority, is declared passed. President Cullerton on Senate Bill 6. I'm sorry, Senator Staines has a floor. Senator Staines is going to be handling the Senate Bill 6 on behalf of President Culleton. Senator Staines seeks leave of the body to return Senate Bill 6 to the order of second reading. Leave is granted. On the order of second reading, Senate Bill 6, Mr. Secretary, are there any floor amendments approved for consideration?
Floor amendment number 3 offered by President Culleton.
Senator Staines to explain.
Senate floor amendment number 3 is addition. It's a gut replacement, but it retains the underlying language of the bill, but it's also adding in payment for state employees, and we'll have a full discussion on third reading.
Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor will say aye, opposed nay. The ayes have it, and the amendment has been adopted. Are there any further floor amendments approved for consideration?
Floor amendment number 4 offered by President Culleton.
Senator Staines seeks leave of the body to return. Is there any discussion? All those in favor say aye, opposed nay. The ayes have it, and the amendment is adopted. Are there any further floor amendments approved for consideration?
No further amendments reported, Mr. President.
Third reading. Now the order of third reading is Senate Bill 6. Mr. Secretary, please read the bill.
Senate Bill 6, an act concerning appropriations, third reading of the bill.
Senator Staines to explain.
Yes, thank you, Mr. President and members of the Senate. So as we know, as of the beginning of this year, January 1st, we no longer had an appropriation budget for much of the budget. A number of items are continuing to get paid by court order or because of continuing appropriations, things like Medicaid or pension payments, debt service. Employee salaries have been under the court order. And we had passed a bill for K-12 funding, and we'd passed bills the stopgap for half of the year. This bill is now a supplemental to make sure that everyone's getting paid who is not getting covered right now for the second half of the year. So it will ensure that our social service agencies, higher education institutions, the MAP grants of students who are affected by MAP grants, and we have also included an amendment in case we don't know what's going to happen in the courts with employee salary. We've included an amendment now to make sure that employees will get paid regardless of the outcome of the court order. And it also provides state operational dollars as well so that our vendors can continue to get paid. And lastly, it also includes an appropriation for group health that we know many of us now, state employees are having a hard time getting their doctors to see them or to have to pay up front because they've not gotten paid for so long. So in what this bill is doing then in its entirety now is appropriating $7.7 billion all funds, $7.4 billion of that is general revenue funds. And I'm happy to answer any questions about the details of what all is getting appropriated in that if anyone has questions. I certainly urge an aye vote. I think it's critical that we enable full funding for all these organizations that right now are not. Including domestic violence shelters that we know had been left out of the stopgap. This is fully funding those domestic violence shelters as well. Thank you.
Is there any discussion? Senator Reiter.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the sponsor yield briefly, please?
Sponsor indicates you'll yield.
Thank you, Mr. President. Senator Staines, you mentioned the court order issue decree, consent decree issue and the spending that is going on pursuant to those provisions. Does this supplemental affect that? In other words, will this make those go away?
Senator Staines.
No, I do not believe so. I mean, that's my understanding.
Senator Ryder.
Thank you. Do you have an understanding, Senator Staines? Because I do not. If this doesn't do it, if an appropriation won't do it, do you have an understanding of what we need to do in order to kind of wrest control of that appropriations away from a court order, let's say, back into the hands of the General Assembly where it properly belongs?
Senator Staines.
So I'm not sure I know entirely what would make a court order go away, so I'm not sure I really am in a position to be able to answer that. What I can say is that this appropriation bill, outside of just the state employee payment, anything that is getting covered right now under court orders is not appropriated in this bill, nor was it appropriated in the stopgap. So I don't think we're impacting those things.
Senator Reiter.
That might be our answer, because we're not appropriating into those areas. Senator Steens, can you tell me, based on the current revenue estimate for FY17, and if you add this supplemental to the GRF spending, what will be our projected deficit for FY17?
Senator Steens.
So the estimate I have right now, but it may be getting tweaked because I think the revenue bill may still be having some adjustments. But assuming that that's passed, the last estimate I've seen on that would have us getting in about $2 billion more for this current fiscal year from the revenue bill. And based on our estimates of what would get spent right now, we'd end up having a deficit of about a little under $4.4 billion. It does enable us to now, going forward, starting fiscal year 18, actually have a balanced budget and into the future as well.
Seeing no further discussion, Senator Steens, do you wish to close?
Yes, I highly encourage yes votes on this. I think it's critical. We have been devastating so many organizations around the state, our higher education institutions, as we know right now. We have some that are really at risk of accreditation issues. Many of them are at risk of having to do serious layoffs, including students, employees. Many MAP grant students don't know whether or not they're going to be able to stay in school. We have many social service agencies that have been closing their doors. We need to provide stability to them. I very much encourage an aye vote on this bill. Thank you.
The question is, shall Senate Bill 6 pass? All those in favor will vote aye. Opposed, vote nay. The voting is open. Have all voted who wish? Have all voted who wish? Have all voted who wish? Take the record. There are 42 voting yea, 16 voting nay, 1 voting present. Senate Bill 6, having received the constitutional majority, is declared passed.
You're watching the Illinois Channel, an independent nonprofit corporation formed to provide gavel-to-gavel coverage of Illinois state government and other public affairs events taking place across Illinois.
Hi, I'm Matt Hart, Executive Director of the Illinois Trucking Association. For over 80 years, we've represented the interests of those who work in the Illinois trucking industry. We work with members of the legislature to pass laws to help make the roads safer, to help keep Illinois trucking competitive, and to help provide ongoing educational opportunities for those in our industry. The technology of trucking is forever changing. So too are the laws regulating the trucking industry. That's why the Illinois Trucking Association is proud to support the work of the Illinois Channel, which keeps citizens around Illinois connected to what's happening in state government and what changes are being discussed that will impact their families, their communities, their future. And the Illinois Channel gives those of us in industry an opportunity to share our thoughts on public policy with our fellow citizens across Illinois. I'm Matt Hart, Executive Director of the Illinois Trucking Association. I'm also proud to serve on the Illinois Channel's Advisory Council on Transportation. The Illinois Channel, it works for all of us.
Next, from Chicago, Governor Rauner is joined by Felicia Norwood, the director of the Illinois Department of Healthcare and Family Services, along with several doctors, as they discuss proposals to expand managed care of Illinois Medicaid. This runs about 25 minutes.
Thank you for joining us. This is a good day for the people of Illinois. Today we are announcing that we are putting out a request for proposal to managed care organizations across the United States of America to come to Illinois and streamline and modernize and upgrade our managed care system for our Medicaid program. Medicaid is obviously critically important, providing high quality health care to our most vulnerable residents here in Illinois. Our system of Medicaid provision has struggled over the years, hasn't been particularly well managed or strategically led, and we want to change it. We want to make it better, providing higher quality services for everyone in Illinois, provide better value for taxpayers for everyone in Illinois, and to make sure that our high quality health care providers are supported and enabled to provide high quality care in a very effective, efficient basis. Right now, managed care is offered through our Medicaid program in Illinois, but it is only offered in 30-some counties and is only currently covering less than two-thirds of our Medicaid eligible residents. We want to make it available in all 102 counties in the state of Illinois. We want to have it cover more than 80% of our Medicaid patients. And we also want to include coverage for our youth in care, our youth at the Department of Children and Family Services. We want to make sure they are included as well. Today they are not. Managed care is critically important because to provide high quality health services and provide more value for taxpayers, we can't just be paying for procedures. We need to be thinking strategically about the whole patient. We need to be managing health, not just sickness. We need to be preventing healthcare problems to make sure that our people are taken care of properly and effectively and providing value. So that's what this is about. Today we've got, last year we had 13 managed care providers in Illinois. This year we're down to 12. That's too many. It's not an optimal number. Based upon best practices that we can find studying other states, we should probably have half that number. To be efficient about it and effective in it. We need competition, we need competitive bidding, but we also need economy of scale, and we need more rationality in the process. Right now we have three different contracts for different types of our populations. We want to bring that into one contract, and we want to have the number of providers in managed care move from 12 to maybe somewhere between 4 and 7. We are going to cap it at 7, but we'd like to have at least 4, somewhere between 4 and 7 managed care providers. And we think this will provide higher quality services and more value for taxpayers over time. So it's an exciting day. The time frame is we want to, putting out the RFP today. We want to get proposals back by the middle of May, which is a tight time frame. We want to pick those that we deem appropriate to work with by the end of June. And then we want to go forward and implement things starting January 1st. Of 2018. So this is a for government standards and for healthcare standards, it's a fairly aggressive timeline, but we think it's very manageable and very doable. So with that, I'll turn it over to some of our leaders here today, and then we'll do questions on topic, and then after that we'll go questions off topic separately. Well, I'd like to introduce Karen Teitelbaum, who's the CEO of Sinai Health Systems, outstanding healthcare provider, especially one of the most important safety net service providers in America, frankly, and certainly one of the biggest in the state of Illinois. Many of the patients here at Sinai come through the Medicaid program. And Sinai does an outstanding job servicing these patients. We appreciate it very much, and I'll turn it over to Karen Teitelbaum. Thank you.
Good morning and welcome. Governor Rauner, we are just thrilled to have you here today to announce this very important initiative for Medicaid in Illinois. I'd also like to welcome Director Felicia Norwood from the Department of Healthcare and Family Services. The department has been a wonderful partner with Sinai to bring the best possible care to the patients we serve. Sinai Health System is noted as one of the largest providers of care for low-income patients in Illinois. We've seen more and more people covered under the Medicaid expansion. In fact, the percentage of Sinai's patients covered under Medicaid grew from 60% to nearly 70%. This growth coincided with the state's decision to move a large percentage of Medicaid recipients into managed care. And Sinai embraces managed care, and we've worked together with the managed care companies to prevent illness and help our communities be healthier. We've more than just worked side by side, we've actually partnered with a number of managed care companies to improve services for chronic conditions through our innovative health programs in the community, such as pediatric asthma, diabetes, and behavioral health. As with any major initiative, the move to managed care has also posed challenges. managed care companies and healthcare providers are still building the infrastructure to ensure that providers are accredited, billing and payments are efficient and timely, and most importantly, that patients can easily access the healthcare system. We're so pleased today to know that the state of Illinois is planning to address these issues and to help our Illinois Medicaid system be a model for the nation of excellent quality and efficiency. And so now I'd like to introduce our Chairman of Family Medicine, Dr. Ehab Aziz, who will be speaking with you about the clinical benefits that managed care can bring.
Thank you. Thank you, Karen, Governor Rauner, thank you for being here today. The Medicaid managed care proposal, request for proposal, addresses many important issues for me as a primary care provider and for many of my patients as well who suffer from chronic diseases. This will allow them actually to better manage their disease and work with me early on before our first conversation would be in the emergency department. An ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. The disease process actually takes years, if not decades, in the making. Diabetes, for example, is one of the most common chronic diseases that I see. It can be the number one leading cause of blindness, number one leading cause of non-traumatic limb amputation, and number one leading cause of being on dialysis in America. Adding to that, hypertension, high cholesterol can lead to coronary artery disease and heart attack, number one killer in America. Congestive heart failure, emphysema, COPD, depression, drug dependency, certain type of cancer, just to name a few. Expanding care coordination can only be good for the type of patients that we see. They have complicated lives because they have limited resources and many competing demands for these resources. So this can only be good for our patients and for the providers as well. I would like now to introduce Director Norwood, who thank you very much for being here with us.
Good morning. And Karen, thank you again for having us here at Mount Sinai, and I thank you for your partnership and the leadership that you bring to the state in terms of healthcare. The governor explained the compelling reasons we are committed to a reboot of Medicaid managed care and spoke of our major goals. I'd like to briefly lay out our overall elements and the timeline of this process. Managed care can indeed be a great positive for those receiving services and for our taxpayers. In my 2 years at HFS, we have listened intently to our stakeholders to have a much greater understanding of the challenges and, equally important, the opportunities we have to transform our healthcare system in this state. Care coordination is certainly improving the lives of many of our beneficiaries, but there remains so much work to be done. To truly succeed, there must be a larger design that encourages innovation, not just a continuation of fee-for-service under another name, but a system that rewards quality and measures outcomes. Unfortunately, there remain too many obstacles and limitations in our current managed care framework. In fact, there are a number of counties in central Illinois where beneficiaries have actually lost their managed care option in recent months, and providers have faced many difficulties. Similar challenges are being confronted in other parts of the state. There are various reasons why managed care is not working as well as we would like today. For one reason, the program was launched with a very large number of health plans, accountable care entities, and care coordination entities, over 30 in total. And while we reduced the number of contracted entities over 2015 and 2016 to roughly 13 and have 12 plans today, we saved the taxpayers $60 million in terms of reducing the number of plans, but the 12 remaining plans we have today is still a large number. That means far too much red tape, administrative difficulties for providers, and confusion in some parts of our state for beneficiaries as they try to navigate the healthcare system and even select a plan. In other parts of the state, there's little to no choice at all. So managed care 1.0, as we call it, was about migrating managed care Medicaid beneficiaries into care coordination, an important and very positive first step. But managed care 2.0 is about transforming this healthcare system we have in this state. In the Department of Healthcare and Family Services, we have a budget of $21 billion. So this is about trying to serve the most vulnerable in a much more efficient and effective way and bringing long-term fiscal sustainability to this Medicaid program. With this RFP, we will be awarding bids to no more than 7 plans in Illinois. By setting a reasonable number of plans, we are addressing one of the chief concerns we have heard from hospitals, physicians, and other providers to the administrative difficulty they have with so many plans today. We are confident that with this approach, we will increase provider participation and satisfaction. Next, as the governor mentioned, today we cover managed care in only 30 counties in the state of Illinois. This will be a statewide RFP offering choice to Medicaid beneficiaries in all 102 counties and eliminating the challenge that we currently face today in central Illinois with limited to no choice. We must not just move from fee-for-service to 30 counties and paying for volume. We must pay for value in this program across the entire state. We will be consolidating 3 separate managed care contracts into 1 simplified contract going forward. And equally important, we will be standardizing our drug formulary, as opposed to allowing 12 different plans to maintain 12 different formularies, as they do today, creating confusion for beneficiaries and providers. Again, addressing another point of dissatisfaction that we have in the program today. Finally, we will be extending managed care coverage to youth that are in the care of the Department of Children and Family Services, and Director Sheldon will speak about that in a few minutes. But administrative improvements and efficiencies are not our most important goal. They are important in terms of bringing and keeping providers in our program and containing costs. But this RFP strengthens our efforts to pay for positive health outcomes and not just more procedures. There is a great emphasis on prevention as well as managing chronic illnesses. And most importantly, the RFP significantly advances the goals of our recent 1115 demonstration waiver to the federal government, which focuses on the integration of physical and behavioral health, an area where Mount Sinai is already offering significant leadership. We realize that this is a major undertaking, but it's one that has to take place. The RFP that will be released today will be out there for a couple of months. We will have proposals that are due by May 15th. And as the governor mentioned, we plan to make a decision by the end of June with an effective date for January 1st of 2018. Many people say, why don't you wait? Why should we wait? This state deserves a managed care system that effectively serves our beneficiaries and allows us to focus on fiscal sustainability in our Medicaid program going forward. We can and we will make managed care work better for our beneficiaries, our taxpayers, and the providers who are trying to serve our clients every single day. With that, I will turn this over to Director Sheldon to address how this transformation will help children in care of the Department of Children and Family Services. Thank you.
Thank you, Director. Governor Rahner and Director Norwood are leading what I think is one of the most comprehensive transformations of the Medicare system in Illinois. The benefits of that transformation are being extended now for the first time to children and youth in the care of the department through a special managed care system to really coordinate behavioral health and physical health. As Director Norwood has fond of saying, is that over the past year, we have begun to work together as agencies to provide the right services at the right time in the right place. And that's what is being outlined today for the children and youth in our care. The governor recognizes, and in fact, all of us recognize, that identifying health problems early, dealing with them effectively, not only saves money in the long run, but gives people renewed health. We as a government have to pay attention to the whole child. In fact, the whole person. I'm fond of saying that children may be only 25% of our population, but they are 100% of our future, which is the reason that a lot of foster youth who have dealt with trauma, who've dealt with the impacts of what they've experienced in their biological home and what they've experienced in additional trauma as they've come into care, have a higher utilization of behavioral health than physical health. This new RFP really focuses on that and is an attempt to coordinate the behavioral health needs of these youth with their physical health needs. Many of the providers now in the department will have to make now renewed contracts with managed care entities. We will work them through that process. This may appear to be complicated, but if we work together, I think we can do the right thing, not only for the people of Illinois, but more specifically for the children and youth who are in our care. I'm excited about this opportunity. I think the fact that Mount Sinai has allowed this to take place here is a recognition that the healthcare community, particularly hospitals, are excited about looking at managed care in a different way than we have before, and seeing it really focus on dealing with early behavioral health needs, early physical health needs, so that you can prevent long-term suffering in the future. I'm pleased to be here, and I want to thank Director Norwood and Governor. You made an excellent choice in bringing Director Norwood back into governmental services. She has led this agency with vigor and with innovation, and that is somebody that it has been extremely rewarding to partner with. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Now we're going to open up to questions on this topic, and then we'll take a short break, and then we'll do other questions. And anyone up here at the stage is love to answer. Yes.
We're looking at a $21 billion portion of the budget devoted to this. What are your goals after someone responds to the RFP? How much can you get it down?
Oh, I don't think I could speculate on that yet. I think we're going to see what the RFP proposals come back and what they indicate they can do and how they're going to structure things. There's clearly significant savings to be had. I firmly believe that we can increase quality and focus on prevention and focus on mental health and quality of life issues and achieve significant savings for taxpayers and providing higher quality health outcomes for our residents as well.
Governor, will the companies need that you're terminating their contracts early? Will Illinois have to pay a penalty for that at all? Or?
No, this is all designed. I'll let Director Norwood answer, but no, there won't be any penalties. This is done specifically to time with the new rates coming in and to, we want to be best positioned for the changes that are coming with the federal government as well. Well, the director, I'm sure, can add to what I'm about to say. Charles, the issue is we need competition. That helps bring down costs, but we need to take advantage of economies of scale. If you've got too many competitors, they all have overhead, they all have their bureaucracy, they all have their CFOs and their reporting and computers, and pretty soon if you've got too many relative to the population you're serving, you can't bring the cost down enough. So we've studied other states, we've talked to experts around the country, and we think for our size of state, for our situation of population, somewhere between 4 and 7 managed care providers should be an optimal number. We'll see how that goes. And further to the question, we need to streamline. Right now we have 3 separate types of contracts for different residents, for different patients. We need 1 comprehensive contract that everyone can bid on to simplify the process, streamline the process. And then a huge part of bringing down the cost over time is managing health, not episodic treatment after the fact of someone's sick. Let's prevent them from getting ill. Let's prevent them from getting more serious in their illness. And let's treat mental health proactively, because What we found is that mental health challenges are driving much of the other physical ailments and also driving frequent visits to the hospital ER. Well, if we can proactively treat the mental health conditions, proactively treat the whole person, and understand, and those who do have chronic illness, manage their chronic illness, make sure they continue to take their meds, and reward the health plans that work to manage the illness, not just get paid, well, that person came back again tomorrow, they're gonna get paid again and again. Instead of episodic payment for treatment, reward managing the health and enhancing the health of the patient. That's really how it drives the quality higher and brings down the cost overall.
Governor, following up on that, you might say that the more competitors you have, the lower the cost, and if there's scale economies, that'll sort itself out in the bidding. People will bid a lower price for the larger volume. So can you name any economists at the University of Chicago who agree with you on cutting down the number of providers?
The flaw in your argument right there is the way the bidding is done, and they don't know what their population is going to be they're going to get. They don't know how many competitors they'll end up truly having. And you can't, the nature of the bidding, in the private sector, I did a lot of bidding, competitive bidding and competition. I'm a big believer in competition, and I'm a big believer in competition, increasing quality and lowering cost. And for certain types of businesses, certain types of industries, lots of competitors is better. Other businesses, it's absolutely not. And I can say that firsthand, both as the one who's put out contracts, but also been one of the bidders on contracts. And the flaw in the argument that you're putting forward, or someone might be putting forward, is the nature of this contracting process and the nature of the services being provided. Yes?
Can you tell us how much during your tenure managed care has saved the state?
One of the reasons we're changing it is my perception, and I'll ask Director Norwood to comment, is we've done managed care in Illinois, but it's like a lot of things we've done in state government. It's kind of in name only. We do reforms that aren't really reforms. We have managed care, but we are pretty much still fee for service. Well, I'll ask Director Norwood to comment. I will say it's not good, and the reason we need to change it. But I'll let her answer, and then I'll add to it if as appropriate.
Yeah, and I will say it's not bad. It's just that we haven't really moved the needle very much. And a lot of that certainly has to do with the fact that there was a quick migration. And on top of that, one of the things that we see is that you have pretty much a fee-for-service system going on right now in managed care, and not the work that we really see and should see around doing real care coordination, going out and focusing on individuals that are driving large percentages of the costs and making care coordination happen there. So in some respects, I say we've kind of, the low-hanging fruit has happened, individuals that are easy to reach, individuals that are more compliant in terms of participating in their healthcare plan. When you think about some of the challenges, those are the individuals that are repeat in our emergency rooms. How do we do a focus with our providers to make sure that they are equal partners in terms of coordinating care? How do you work with community-based agencies to go out and find individuals who are in the Medicaid program who might be homeless and they don't present at the normal places where you see in the healthcare system? So while we have a situation where, think managed care, we've migrated individuals into care coordination, we haven't really had the focus that we should have on making sure, as Director Sheldon is saying, that people are really getting care in the right place at the right time and for the right cost.